Thank you for being here this evening to help raise awareness and understanding of NTM lung disease and how to diagnose and treat it. We need a cure, and that must remain our goal. It's funny how we don't think about good health when we have it. But my wife Fern's diagnosis with NTM lung disease changed everything. In that moment, we couldn't possibly understand the long-term impact on our lives and the never-ending battle ahead. No longer could we stay out all day without a care in the world or travel whenever or wherever we wanted to. Our eureka moment came in 2002 when two experts visited Miami to lecture to 35 pulmonologists about NTM. Most have heard of it, but had not diagnosed it because they weren't looking for it, and even fewer had an understanding of the complexities of treatment. If doctors didn't understand it, can you imagine how their patients felt? That evening, Fern and I decided to create ntminfo.org, a website to provide information for patients. Our mission is simple: help patients by providing information and creating resources to meet their needs. Collectively, with other patients, we have reached out to government, governmental agencies, and assisted in the formation of over 30 support groups. We've also provided seed funding for pivotal research and provided funding for a patient registry module for NTM. Paradoxically, our worries are greater today than 12 years ago because we know more. Too many patients have died and too many have endured failed treatments. Despite the scientific curiosity and the brilliant minds that are tackling the problem of pulmonary NTM, we still need to find the resources to do the research that's needed. The sponsors of tonight's event, Insmed, is helping shine a light on NTM lung disease and is advancing the science and helping to bring hope to Fern and thousands like her. You too can help patients by telling your colleagues about NTM and participating in the quest for better treatments and a cure. It will happen, and we should all be part of it. Thank you for being here, and our thanks to Insmed for making this evening possible.
Please join me in welcoming the chair of our program, Dr. Charles Daley. Dr. Daley is a professor of medicine and the chief of the Division of Mycobacterial and Respiratory Infections at National Jewish in Denver, Colorado. Dr. Daley, welcome.
Thank you, Jeff. Wow. Look at all of you out there. That's fantastic. It's really exciting to have this many people come and join us tonight. We hope this will be an interactive session. We're going to use some technology to help us do that. I'd like to begin, first of all, by thanking NTMIR and Insmed for supporting tonight's session. I think it's very important that they've done this because we're trying to raise awareness about NTM. I look through the audience. I see some of you who have published a great deal on the subject. I know there's some of you who may not have taken care of many patients with NTM, but we hope the session will be beneficial to all. I'd like to introduce my panel. The first is David Griffith. David, would you come up?
Sure.
David is a professor of medicine and chief of the Division of Pulmonary Medicine at the University of Texas Health Science Center in Texas. You can see he has a number of other titles. We actually had to cut the slide off, but couldn't get them all on there. But we welcome David. My next panelist is Ken Olivier. Ken? Ken is chief of pulmonary clinical medicine. He's the acting chief right now, and this is in the cardiovascular pulmonary branch at NHLBI. A few weeks ago, you might have known him as someone who was in NIAID, so he's just made a switch, and we think that's great for NTM and also bronchiectasis to have someone like him now over in the pulmonary section. Kevin Winthrop is the next panelist. Kevin is associate professor in the departments of infectious diseases, ophthalmology, public health, and preventive medicine. There's got to be a story there with all of those different sections. So this is our esteemed panel tonight. Hopefully we'll be able to pick their brains a little bit about NTM. Thank
Thanks,
you.
Jeff.
These are the conflicts that you see, or disclosures. None of us are receiving any compensation for this tonight. So we're going to first start with just thinking about the importance of an early diagnosis. I'm going to begin the discussion very briefly, just so we can move into the meat of the discussions that my friends will be leading. So the importance of an early diagnosis. The objectives are to develop a deeper understanding of NTM lung infection and their serious consequences if they're left undiagnosed and untreated, to identify the telltale signs and symptoms to look for in your patients. I think most of you will be very familiar with those. And, you know, really what we're trying to do as part of raising awareness is to elevate NTM in the differential diagnosis of pulmonary physicians, infectious disease physicians, and also primary providers. And we need to do this because this is a problem that continues to grow. This is looking at the annual prevalence of pulmonary NTM cases among U.S. Medicare Part B beneficiaries from 1997 to 2007. And I think this was just an incredible study. It's very striking, the results of this study. Now, note that this is an older population. This is because of who was sampled, this U.S. Medicare enrollee. So 65 and older. But what you see in the y-axis are the pulmonary NTM cases per 100,000 persons over this time frame, stratified by gender. Starting out back in 1997, there were about 20 per 100,000 cases, and you can see what's been happening. It's been increasing at about 8% per year. That increases in both men and women, although it's more so in women. But now these, particularly in women, we've seen a doubling of that prevalence. So this is a pretty striking study. It should call us to attention that this is a disease process that is not going away, it's increasing. And it turns out that's probably an underestimate. We're probably underestimating, because of misdiagnosis and no diagnosis of NTM, by as much as anywhere from 25 to 75%. NTM pulmonary disease, as opposed to infection or indolent infection, whatever we might want to decide to call it tonight, is underdiagnosed. It's often misdiagnosed because patients have comorbidities. They have COPD, they have bronchiectasis. So the symptoms that relate to that disease can confuse us, and we may not think that NTM is actually present. And again, this is only going to get worse, because we have an aging population, and this occurs in higher rates in aging or older individuals. We know from the studies here that hospitalizations due to pulmonary NTM are 15-fold higher for women and 9-fold higher for men in an older age category compared to a younger age category, 40 to 49 years of age. And we also know that we're expecting to see that older population increase. It's been estimated that by 2030 that people over or 60 or older will be increasing by about 25%. What you see in the figure here, again, are cases per 100,000 based on age. This is from an average annual prevalence, looking at age from the group health in Kaiser in Southern California. And you can, again, see that the rates that I gave you earlier were related to gender, but when you look at it related to age, again, we see significant rates in the older population getting up close to 55 per 100,000 in the 80 plus. So this is something that's not going away. It is increasingly important to us in pulmonary and infectious disease medicine, and therefore that's why we're here, is to try to raise awareness and get all of us diagnosing these patients. So we're going to now go to the first survey question. At what point should you consider NTM in your differential diagnosis? So choose one of these. Upon presentation of symptoms, for example, a cough, only after multiple positive cultures, after multiple rounds of failed antibiotic therapy, or after radiographic presentation consistent with NTM. At what point would you consider NTM? Okay. So upon presentation of symptoms, like a cough, 51% of you said you would consider NTM. That seems pretty good. Only after multiple positive cultures. So 10% of you need a little convincing. After multiple rounds of failed antibiotics, 22%. And then after radiographic presentation consistent with NTM, 17%. I don't know. Ken, does that surprise you in any way?
No, I think all of those things are part of, you know, what goes into the decision about when to consider NTM. And I think the majority of the people, you know, citing presentation of symptoms of chronic cough, I think if you couple that with the appropriate demographics, especially older patients, postmenopausal women have been described as a very common demographic. And I think if you have that patient presenting with chronic cough and appropriate symptoms, that may be a time to at least consider the diagnosis. Certainly as you get to some of these other factors that should be increasing your thoughts about considering NTM as a possibility for their presentation.
Okay. Kevin, anything to add to that?
I would just add the same thing as Ken, and that it's really the a priori probability or a priori risk. It's the right people. I mean, if you start looking at 40-year-olds or 45 and 50-year-olds, older people, and up, you know, you really start.
How did
to
you look at him?
Yeah, well, you start to see the risk go higher. So it's the chronic unexplained cough. I always like to say the unexplained cough. I mean, there are algorithms for evaluating chronic cough, and once you go through that algorithm, you don't identify the usual suspects, asthma, you know, GERD, et cetera, then I think you need to start thinking more seriously about this entity, particularly if it's the right person. The only other thing I'll add is, you know, I've seen more and more younger people with this, particularly younger women in their 30s or 40s, and I think it's pretty unusual in that age group, but I think it's there, and I think some of those folks then take, you know, a decade before they end up getting diagnosed, so I wouldn't rule it out even in someone younger.
Dave, I see a question that's already come through that seems relevant to this, and that is, how common is NTM in patients who present with chronic cough? Seems like you're thinking of zebras, not horses, when considering NTM. So we're talking about cough here is one of the presenting symptoms of people, but how often is that going to be NTM?
Well, I wish we had better numbers about that, but I was impressed by one of our esteemed colleagues a few years ago who said that he felt that in a woman over 50 who presented with chronic cough, that bronchiectasis and or NTM disease was probably the most likely diagnosis. And Ken has pointed out that in the ATS cough algorithm, cough diagnostic algorithm, you've got to move down pretty far before you even consider that. So it would be, you know, it's like all of the other problems we have looking at incidence and prevalence of these diseases. But my guess is that as these guys have pointed out, in the right population, this might be one or two on the differential list, depending on who, you know, where they've sit.
Yeah, I agree. I think it gets back to the risk factors. So a chronic cough in a thin, postmenopausal or older woman, I mean, it's going to be up there as a cause of their cough. So it depends, I think, on risk factors, again, as you were alluding to. Okay. So we're going to move on. So the next section, recognition and diagnosis of NTM pulmonary infections. I'm going to hand that down.
Okay. The misdiagnosis of NTM disease certainly can put you down the wrong path therapeutically. And of particular significance, I think, in this category, is the use of macrolide as an immune modulating agent. I mean, the macrolides have really come into their own recently in a number of chronic inflammatory lung diseases, cystic fibrosis, asthma, bronchiectasis, and others, bronchiolitis. But without recognizing the coexistence, for instance, of NTM infection in patients who have chronic obstructive lung disease or bronchiectasis, certainly would put that individual at risk for developing macrolide-resistant, particularly MAC isolates, were they treated with macrolide monotherapy. The second point there, overtreatment, insufficient treatment, unproven treatment regimens have been found to occur. I would say that's a gross understatement. Insmed sponsored a survey of physicians in the United States and their prescribing practices for NTM disease, and it was an eye opener. your colleagues, and I'm going to give everyone in the room a pass on this one, but those people who aren't here had very unusual prescribing practices for treating NTM disease, and practices that had the potential commonly to promote macrolide resistance in MAC therapy. And one very interesting aspect of the study was these physicians were asked if they were following ATS treatment guidelines, and a large percentage said that they were, when in fact it was a small minority of the physicians who were surveyed were actually following those guidelines. Disease recognition is extraordinarily important, particularly in this era when we use macrolides as immune modulators, but then recognition and treatment in appropriate manner, I think, is equally important.
So I guess we have a survey question next, and you're welcome to punch your iPad. When considering a diagnosis of NTM, what is the top indicator that helps you differentiate NTM from underlying chronic respiratory conditions? Choose one, and I won't read the choices. I'll let you do that. And can we have that music back again? Okay, I'll triage the answer for Dr. Daley here. So number one is microbiologic evidence. I'm surprised the hot tub isn't higher. That's a little disappointing. Chuck, what do you think of the results? What is your...
Microbiologic evidence, half the people believe that would be the top indicator. Well, I mean, this is a microbiologic diagnosis ultimately, right? It's positive culture. So that has got to be at the top of your list. Followed 22% tree and bud pattern on CT. So tree and bud, you know, is certainly one of the things I think nowadays we're all getting CTs. It's one of the first time we think about it is when the radiologist puts tree and bud pattern. And then we go, maybe that's a mycobacterial infection. But it doesn't have to be. It could be something else. But clearly, it sounds like the imaging and the microbiology is what people are really keying on in practice. I don't know. What do you guys think? Ken?
Well, I agree. I think, you know, a lot of times on radiographic interpretation, depending on where it's read, if there are tree and bud infiltrates there, it'll say, you know, MAC disease or NTM disease. But I think the important point is that, you know, some of those changes, even the tree and bud infiltrates, are not really specific of a particular microbiologic diagnosis. And I think that it's very important that sputum specimens are obtained or the appropriate respiratory specimens to confirm that that's actually the cause of it. And that kind of gets into the whole issues of treatment and making sure that you know what the species is and as much as you can about the organism. So I agree with the audience that you know, certainly is a top indicator, but there are a variety of other things that should make you consider the diagnosis that would push you toward trying to get the appropriate respiratory specimen to confirm that.
Okay. Yeah, I'll just share my anecdote. I had a referral the other day from the ER. And this is actually a patient who came in with respiratory complaints. They had a CT done, like everyone else in the ER. And they had tree and bud infiltrates, and our radiologist read it out. It's, you know, consistent with potential MAI, pulmonary MAI. So the ER physician put the patient on three drugs. They actually followed the guidelines, David mentioned. And they sent him to me. I was flabbergasted. There's no microbiology, no sputum specimens, nothing, but just three drugs and follow up with Dr. Winthrop. So I'm not sure that was the right thing to do, but at least they're thinking. They have NTM in their differential, I guess. But.
All right, well, let's.
I guess I would only add that I don't know how the other panel members feel, but I can count on the number of zero fingers the patients I put on empiric therapy.
Yeah.
That it just isn't part of the, I mean, for pulmonary MAC disease, I don't see it as part of the care of patients.
I completely agree. I think it's a really important point. I do think, going back to the last slide, and something I was asked today after a talk was, You know, what do you do with that patient who radiographically looks exactly like they've got MAC, they've got right middle lobe bronchiectasis, they have treme butt infiltrates, and their sputums are negative, you bronch them, their bronch negative, what do you do? I mean, that's a tough patient, and I don't know if one of you wants to comment on that.
Well, I think that leads into the next discussion.
Yeah, probably we should say.
How do you make the diagnosis?
Yeah. Well, so let's talk about the case criteria. These are case criteria that all of us on this panel and some of you in the room here were part of a committee 7 or 8 years ago where we sat around the table and debated how to define a case of pulmonary NTM. And I think what ended up is what is on the slide here, and it reflected an appropriate balance of sensitivity and specificity. And we all know that people can have NTM in their respiratory secretions, and it doesn't necessarily mean they have a problem or disease. So we felt that you know, patients really needed to have some radiographic evidence of disease and symptoms, of course, and no other explanation, i.e. they didn't have tuberculosis. And then they have to have microbiologic evidence of disease. And we set the bar a little higher, and that we didn't allow just one sputum, but we thought that the patient should have at least 2 positive sputums. And this, we do run into this problem sometimes, getting that second positive sputum. We also felt that a lower respiratory tract specimen, or BAL, or tissue specimen that grew out in NTM would be sufficient to qualify the person for meeting the case criteria, in knowing that they already have radiographic evidence of disease and symptoms. So that's the case definition. And since that time, a number of us here and in the audience have done work to try to validate that case definition. And I'll just share with you some results from a study in Oregon. This was a population-based study that looked at all the patients in Oregon over a 2-year time period that had respiratory NTM isolates, sputum or BAL or otherwise. And what really surprised me about the study, and I think is the take-home message, is that 50% of people in the state that had a positive respiratory sample had disease. 50%. 50%. And now, certainly, if you looked at the group under age 20, that was a lot lower. The group was dominated by older people. But population-wise, in the state, 50% of people with a positive sample in their respiratory tract had true disease. And that was a lot higher than I was expecting when we went into that project. And then before I ask you guys for comment, I'll just say that, you know, the micro criteria alone, we did some validation work around that. They have very high positive predictive value. If you have 1 BAL or if you've got 2 sputums, for example, then, you know, probably somewhere between 86 and 100% of those people have true disease, depending on how old you are and what your chronic conditions are. So the micro criteria alone are quite predictive for who actually has true disease. So. David, do you have comments on that?
Well, I assume that depends also on species identification.
Absolutely.
So, a silly example, 1 BAL sample for Mycobacterium gordoni has no predictive value for disease, and you pointed that out. But, you know, I think it's a drum that needs to be beaten pretty commonly is, You have to know something about the isolates and the species that you isolate. That's probably the biggest weakness of the diagnostic criteria. They're not suitable for every potential NTM pathogen.
I'm glad you brought that up, because in those studies we excluded M. gordoni,
right.
So it's absolutely right. I mean, you often see that species and it almost never has clinical relevance. But.
Right, well, keep going.
NTM disease characteristics differ by sex. So the point of this slide is really to point out that there's kind of 2 phenotypes of disease. There's this male disease and female disease. But I will say that there's lots of women with the male disease and lots of males with the female disease. So there's quite a bit of overlap. But you can see in the blue square there that COPD tends to be more common in men with this disease, and bronchiectasis tends to be more common in women with this disease. And there's also some data, again, this is population-based data too, that a lot of these patients are taking immunosuppressive therapies, either oral prednisone or inhaled corticosteroids. And there's been some studies done in the last few years suggesting that that is a risk factor for acquiring NTM. So there's probably lots of risk factors out there, aging, comorbidities, and also some of the therapies maybe we're using to treat those conditions.
And I think there's a couple of points on this slide that are important. This is looking at comorbidities from patients who died from their NTM disease. And one of them is something that everybody in this room knows, that is aware of. Everyone who presents to you with NTM disease has at least two lung diseases. They've got their NTM disease and they have bronchiectasis or COPD. Of course, the management of those problems is often quite complicated, and the management of one interferes with the management of the other. And I mean, they're difficult patients, of course. But the second point I'd like to make is the striking thing about this slide to me is the high incidence of COPD, and perhaps the connection here is that it is people dying from NTM disease. I think our colleagues in Asia and Europe have shown very well that mortality is higher in patients with cavitary NTM disease. And as we all know, cavitary NTM disease tends to occur more commonly in cigarette smokers and patients with COPD. And I think this is a clarion call that when we have patients who have COPD and cavitary NTM disease, those people deserve our very best because there is no question that they are at higher risk of mortality than patients with nodular and bronchiectatic disease. I know many of you, the majority of the patients you see are the bronchiectatic type patients. In my practice, we're probably 60-40 bronchiectasis COPD. But again, having said that, I think that there is no room for nihilism in evaluating and treating these patients with underlying obstructive lung disease.
You're a nihilist.
Thank you.
To further that point, possible clinical indicators for NTM, does your patient have any of the following? Unexplained chronic cough, multiple rounds of antibiotics in 12-month period, abnormal radiographic findings. I think we've already covered that. I mean, this again is just reminding you that in that patient in the right demographic who has an unexplained cough, start thinking of NTM. So to further David's point, this is actually a patient of mine, and this is a woman that has the male form of the disease, to further that point. And this is a smoker and someone who has emphysema and has cavitary MAI. Actually, interestingly enough, you could barely see that cavity on the chest radiograph. It was missed on the chest x-ray, and it was only later picked up as she became more symptomatic and eventually had a CT scan. So I want to point that out. The other point is that this is someone you can cure. If this person walks out of your practice and comes back 2 years later, this is probably someone you can't cure. And they'll have multiple cavities, they'll have spread to other areas of the lung, and it'll be very difficult to eradicate this. So the point is, even if you don't start someone on therapy, keeping them close to you and your practice with repeated surveillance, I think is really important, because if they are progressing, and particularly if they have cavitary disease, there's really no reason not to start treating a cavity in my mind.
Oh, that's okay. This is a patient that I have seen recently. You can see there was a CAT scan done in 2011 showing relatively extensive bronchiectasis in the right lung, and then in 2013 you can see there's a destroyed lobe related to bronchiectasis. And I would like to make just a point or two about this particular patient. The patient was relatively asymptomatic, not completely of course, but relatively between 2011 and 2013. I know you guys frequently hear folks like us say that diagnosing NTM disease is not does not obligate you to treat an individual for NTM disease, that everything is a balance of risk and benefit. And I want to very strongly echo what Kevin just said. Knowing these patients well is just absolutely essential to their care, and long-term follow-up of these patients, there is no substitute. We look at our patients as lifetime patients for several reasons. But forgive me, one other point about this is that this patient was not treated between 2011 and 2013 while this occurred. With the justification was that the patient had few symptoms. Well, as everybody is aware, you have microbiologic, the diagnosis and treatment depends on microbiologic criteria, radiographic criteria, and symptom criteria. And any one of those is not, frequently is not, may or may not be adequate. In this case, it was only the physician relied on symptoms alone deciding what to do about the patient. And again, you know, common sense tells you, yes, there are people that don't require therapy, but as Kevin suggested, if you don't treat that person, you don't let them go. I'm not suggesting you CAT scan them every 3 months, but you follow them carefully. And in this case, I mean, I think this is a tragic result. The person was not treated simply because the physician did not feel the symptoms justified initiating therapy. So to try to build something positive out of this, no matter how symptomatic a patient was, if they have progressive destruction of a lobe of their lung, I'm going to suggest that they get treated.
Let's use that as a segue.
Yeah.
Okay.
To treatment. So here's another survey question. Now you have to get this one right. When you initiate therapy for NTM lung
question.
Disease,
yeah.
Do you follow ATS IDSA guidelines? We know who's saying what.
We won't judge you, so go ahead and be honest.
Be honest. Okay, we love you.
We knew this was a special room of people.
Bias.
So it looks like most of you follow the guidelines.
Well, I'd like to congratulate the 14% of you who are honest.
However, that's not the case of, you know, what is going on in a lot of other places outside of this room in practice. And this was a study that David alluded to earlier that was a survey of practicing physicians. And this was a mixture of pulmonologists, infectious disease doctors, internists, and general practitioners who saw at least more than one patient with NTM over the prior year. And so they were asked to pull the records and to review what went into the decision to treat and what treatment regimens they were treated with. And I think all of us and many of you in the room were quite shocked at the results that came up with this. So this was, a look back at what actually happened in the people who, you know, treated patients with this disease. And as it turns out, only 13% of the regimens prescribed for Mycobacterium avium complex followed those guidelines. So they were a far shot off from the 87% of people in here. And the typical guideline recommendation for Mycobacterium avium complex consists of a macrolide, ethambutol, and rifampin. Among the pulmonologists, we think of ourselves as, you know, sort of a special breed. Only 18% follow the regimens that met these criteria. So it really didn't matter a whole lot what the specialty was when you broke it down and looked between these different groups of physicians in terms of whether or not they followed the guidelines or not, or what they actually did. More concerning is that 30% of those regimens for Mycobacterium avium complex were regimens that would have or had been shown to lead to development of resistance, or at least have a significant percentage of or likelihood of developing resistance from that. If you break it down by specialty of pulmonologists, it was, you know, a little bit better, but there was still a large number of combinations of either a macrolide alone or macrolide with rifampin or macrolide with a quinolone didn't provide adequate protection for preventing resistance from developing. The flip side of that is that only 56% of those regimens included a macrolide. And that's really the only class of drugs that's been shown to correlate with clinical response for Mycobacterium avium complex. So that's a little discouraging in terms of the makeup of those regimens. We know a lot less about the regimens that are appropriate for M. abscessus, but at least the thought is that a macrolide should be considered in those patients, and the frequency that that occurred in that setting was not so great either. So I don't know, do you guys have any, David, any comments you want to expand on that? You were the senior author on this this study.
Well, I was floored. It was more depressing than I could have imagined. Let me drag myself up from the floor of cynicism here for a minute. The takeaway, if I could give one message here, it would be, I know a lot of you guys are frustrated with results that you get in treating your patients, and I share your frustrations. What this tells me, and again, I guess it doesn't apply to anybody in this room. What this tells me is, our therapies are not perfect. They leave a lot to be desired, absolutely, but we could raise the bar so much higher if folks would just treat according to guidelines. They're not perfect. Maybe they're not even good. I don't know. But in our series of patients that we recently reported, treating according to guidelines with nodular bronchiectatic MAC disease, we got an initial about 84% sputum conversion rate. So I would only say, we need, and Chuck will talk more about this, we need better drugs, we need, there's lots that we need. But my gosh, we could do so much better than we're doing if everybody just would go with what's recommended.
So David, one of the questions is, why did they not follow the guidelines? Did you ask them why?
I don't think we did, Chuck.
Yeah, did they not know about them, or did they just decide they didn't like them and had their...
Well, we should, you know...
We can't ask right now, but...
The 14% out there. Yeah.
Moving on. Okay. Let's kind of wrap up this, and then we'll go to the questions. So let's take another survey question. What would trigger your decision to treat a patient who is NTM isolated from the sputum? Chronic cough, failed two or more rounds of antibiotic treatment, susceptibility to NTM infection based on comorbid disease, or radiographic findings of cavitation. To the radiograph again, so 55% cavitation. So you see cavitation, you have lung destruction. You know it's harming the patient. So and we know it's associated with poor outcomes. So that seems like a very reasonable response in terms of deciding who to treat. 24% said susceptibility to NTM infection. So underlying bronchiectasis, cystic fibrosis, something that makes you concerned that this patient is susceptible. And then the others are follow. So sounds, I think we covered this before in terms of the importance of cavitation.
Sure.
Why don't we do, I think there's another question. So what would cause you to hesitate then to initiate treatment or not to treat? So we know what made you want to treat. Now what would make you not want to treat? Guidelines are not applicable for all patients. Difficult to diagnose in patients with chronic diseases and similar symptoms, complex and burdensome treatment, other.
So,
yeah, I'm colorblind. How about you?
Okay, so I'm colorblind, so it doesn't matter to me. So I can just tell you.
They're all the same color.
That's true. Chuck and I are both colorblind.
So let me just summarize this, because I can't figure out that graph. But you know, we're not saying that the treatment is easy. And you know, there, as David was saying earlier, there's always a risk benefit ratio that you have to weigh about whether you're going to make the patients better or worse with treatment. It's also not the kind of treatment that you can give them a box of drugs to take home, have them start them all right away, and assume that they're going to do it, one, and two, that it's all going to work out. It does take some effort to get them on this complex regimen. It takes effort to keep them on it and to be able to follow them. And there are other issues that are sort of on the negative aspect.
Let's move the slide.
We move
next.
The slide onto the next one. There are other treatment limitations. You know, there are studies that have been shown, particularly with the macrolides, that at standard doses that are used, particularly in certain patient groups, you may not be achieving levels that are adequate to get drug above MIC to adequately cover those patients. And, you know, it may be one of the things to consider when someone's not responding is whether they're actually on adequate doses of the drugs to be able to do that. Trying to get them on higher doses is not always so easy either. Frequently, patients are limited by toxicity of the drugs that preclude you from raising that up. And then there have been studies that have been done that have shown that the frequency of toxicity is not trivial. In some studies, up to 100% of the patients that are started on these have dose-limiting toxicity that requires some manipulation of the drugs. So I think the key is that if you make the decision to treat, that it's going to take a little effort to get them on it, to encourage patients on it, and to make sure they're not staying at home suffering in silence, but working with you to try to get on to a regimen that they can tolerate.
Okay, that's great. Now, so while we've been up here talking, you've been out there typing, because there's a lot of questions here. And so we're going to go through these, and we're going to be rapid fire. So our responses will be?
Rapid.
And concise. Yeah. So yes. So why don't we just start going through these. So one of the questions that you all have asked is, are there regional variations in the type of NTM found in patients?
Yes.
Yes.
Next.
No, I'm just kidding. Since you started, so give us, you know.
I'll just do a quickie. Yeah, absolutely. It was interesting. I was approached by a guy today from Southern California who said, boy, I've seen like 5 Zenopi cases in the last 6 months. I've never seen Zenopi in 30 years, which is interesting. That mirrors my experience in Oregon, too. I don't know. I think we don't really have very good data to answer this question. I mean, we know that there's some regional distributions. Kinzasia is more common in the South. Zenopi shouldn't be hanging out in Oregon and California, but it seems like maybe it is. We really don't know. And there's a nice paper published this year that really looked at this worldwide. That really showed there is some sometimes very large differences in the proportion of species that are being present in pulmonary disease. For example, just within MAC, Mycobacterium avium complex, you know, Europe has a much higher proportion of intracellulari than we do, and that may have some clinical implications. So the short answer is yes, but the long answer is we need more data to really better understand that.
Has anyone, or why do we not change lab practice so that we get AFB microbiology on all
specimens?
Is that mustache samples? What is that?
So, I don't know, David, you were talking about resistance. So, in terms of the microbiology, why don't we get microbiology, AFB cultures on all specimens?
I don't know. That would be the short version. The long version is that the lab is way behind the crest of the wave, yeah. Labs in the United States for managing patients with NTM disease, both in terms of, it looks like simple things like smears and cultures, but in very important things like species identification, ERM gene identification, genotyping. It's a big problem, I think, and I know some of my colleagues. Ann O'Donnell at Georgetown, for instance, is something that's a big irritant to Ann, is that there is not uniform excellence or even uniform up-to-date technology in mycobacteriology laboratories. It's a big problem, and it's one I think that everyone would agree we need to address.
But I think a key thing to emphasize here is that there are specific laboratory procedures that need to be taken that are different from, say, looking for regular bacteria or respiratory bacteria on a sputum specimen. So I think that, you know, the reasons why it's not obtained every time you submit a specimen is that it requires the lab to set up a different set of plates to take different measures to make sure that they can isolate mycobacteria from the specimens. These are very, even the rapid grower organisms are very slow growing relative to bacteria like Pseudomonas or Staph. And if measures aren't taken to suppress those to allow the mycobacteria to grow, you may not recover it.
Ken, why don't you take this one? What's the evidence that macrolide monotherapy in bronchiectasis patients is predictive for resistance?
Well, the person that should take that is David, because he wrote the paper.
But you did another paper looking at it in cystic fibrosis in terms of macrolide monotherapy.
Right. So, you know, what the interest was in cystic fibrosis is whether or not the large percentage of patients, and in the U.S. it's about 65% of CF patients that are on chronic macrolides for their immunomodulatory abilities or the ability to sort of decrease the frequency of flares of Pseudomonas, whether that was somehow predisposing to chronic mycobacterial infections. And this came from the concept or the concern came from a paper that was published several years ago looking at the effect that these drugs might have on a housekeeping function of cells called autophagy, with the concern that if you block this mechanism that may be important in mycobacterial control, that might allow chronic infection, particularly with M. abscessus, to occur. So to try to get at this, we did a study along with my colleagues Jenna Jimian and Becky Privo, using the CF Foundation patient registry, identifying a case definition for incident development of mycobacteria, and then correlated that with whether or not they had been on macrolides and the length of time that they had been on macrolides to see if they were more or less likely to develop mycobacteria. And those patients that had been on chronic macrolides actually had an association with fewer incident occurrences of mycobacteria than those that weren't on macrolides. And the longer they had been on macrolides, the less likely they were to develop incident positive cultures. So that's a little bit different than the question that was asked about prediction of resistance.
In bronchiectasis, as opposed to treating people with monotherapy.
Right.
It's a different issue, but go ahead.
No, I guess the short answer is there's not. But there's no question if you have a patient with bronchiectasis and MAC disease and you treat them with macrolide monotherapy, they are at risk of macrolide resistance. I don't know of a way to catch that data, or how would we catch that data?
Well, you did it in the context of a study, you know, within 4 months.
Oh, right.
You knew the percentage that that developed resistance.
Correct. And those were people with diagnosed MAC disease. But in the broader...
bronchiectasis.
Yeah, yeah. I would only suggest that, as is suggested, that prior to treating patients with chronic lung disease, screen for NTM infection before giving them monotherapy with macrolide.
Okay. All right. How about the next question? A nice, easy one. How is NTM transmitted? And should it be a reportable disease like TB? Who would like to raise their hand?
Maybe I should take that one. It's hot tubs, right? It's all hot tubs.
Hot tubs.
These are environmental bugs. There's some evidence that some of these bugs are actually person to person, and Ken was involved in an outbreak investigation in Seattle in a CF clinic with Mycobacterium abscessus subspecies Mycelliens, which is a something that we've more recently recognized as a subspecies of abscessus. But it was very clear from the molecular subtyping involved in that investigation that there was transmission between CF patients. There's also a recent report from England showing the same thing. So I think some probably small percent of M. abscessus disease, at least, is transmitted person to person in the right type of host. And so far, we don't know of this occurring outside the setting of CF. But otherwise, it's acquired from the environment, and we know most of these bugs live in the water and the dirt, and they're pretty ubiquitous. So you can think of all the ways you inhale water and dirt, and those are probably the ways people get them. In terms of whether it should be reportable, I certainly think it should be, and probably you guys do too. In Oregon, We did just make it reportable. So actually, NTM isolates are being reported by labs in Oregon. And I don't know if other states will follow suit, but I think it should happen because I do think it's an emerging public health threat, and it's really an environmental health threat. I mean, these things are coming from the environment. They're in our water supplies, et cetera. So it's something that I think public health should be involved in.
You deserve a pat on the back, by the way, for doing that in Oregon.
We should give him a lot of credit because he drove that through.
It wasn't me. I mean, I had to bribe people with wine and beer. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm joking. But, you know, I've been working
That is what he told me last night. I mean,
it's partially true. But, you know, the state health people in Oregon deserve a lot of credit because they've had a longstanding interest in mycobacterium. And a lot of the work we've been able to do is by facilitated by their interest and recognition of this as a problem. So.
Okay, how about another? Since everyone gets azithromycin for a cough, how long do you wait after stopping azithromycin before getting cultures? Just give me a time.
Immediately. 5 days of azithromycin won't affect anything.
Won't affect your culture result for NTM.
Right.
I agree. I think you can do it right away.
That was a good one. All right. That's probably the only time we have agreed on anything.
Especially that quickly. Yeah.
Okay, it takes 4 to 6 weeks to get accurate identification and sensitivities for NTM. Is there a current test available for earlier identification?
David? Well, with growth, there are molecular tests looking at genetic sequences that can be done. Again, those are specialty laboratories. I'd be curious, I mean, how many laboratories in the United States do that? You guys do, I know.
Well, we do sequencing, you know, of cultures.
That's what I'm talking about. Not a specimen sequence, but if there's growth, you can sequence the organism.
Yeah.
And we can do that. Ken. I just don't know how widely available.
I mean, the problem is that you need growth, and that usually takes 4 to 6 weeks. But I mean, you could use a MAI probe on a raw sputum smear. I don't know.
So you can use a probe that's going to tell you is it TB or not TB. That's
right.
The direct probe. And then if you use the probe that can distinguish species, that's on a culture still. And tells you avium, MAC, avium.
But on a research basis, there are PCR techniques that are looking at direct detection.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be a while before they move into the clinical arena. There was actually an interesting poster presented this morning looking at a technique that allowed rapid direct detection of resistance directly from sputum. So I think those things are coming along, and I think you can look to tuberculosis for some of the prediction of what's going to potentially be available in the future of being able to do both direct detection and rapid assessment of resistance. And I think ideally you would be able to get both of those turned around much quicker than what we can do now.
I think that's the future.
But just note, in Europe they do have Lyme probe assays that can speciate and can be done on a specimen. They were developed for culture, but they have been used on specimens.
Yeah.
I would only just like to say that this is one area of deficiency still in the United States that I think is shameful. And I know it happens to all of us that an isolate is brought to us as abscessus chelonii complex. Totally unacceptable. That the laboratory support has got to improve.
Yeah, I think we agree. I don't understand that one. It says, just how sick do most NTM patients feel? How motivated is the average patient to seek treatment? Well, I think that varies greatly depending on the severity of disease. Any comments regarding that?
I mean, something brings them in, to get it to attention. It's interesting, a lot of times it's a significant other that will notice things like frequent throat clearing or frequent coughing. And I think by the time they finally get through the algorithms and somebody thinks to get a CT scan and look for NTM, many times their symptoms have progressed in that interim period. Again, it depends on the particular patient and whether how bothersome their symptoms are, and only they can tell you that, and how severe their disease is by objective criteria to know how motivated they would be to start treatment and whether that's the right thing to do at that time or not.
Okay,
I agree.
Another question, does the burden of organisms in sputum correlate to time to culture conversion after initiation of therapy? Again, I think this gets into the issue of burden of organisms as extent of disease. And generally speaking, I would say yes, meaning in the cavitary patients typically take longer. People with more radiographic extensive disease take longer.
No, I agree, absolutely.
Another question is what's the role of surgery? And so obviously National Jewish, we do a lot of surgery, mainly because many of you refer people for that specific intervention because of our experience with surgery. And related to that, someone was asking for, on your case with the cavitary disease, did you think about surgery?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think surgery is an important adjunct, particularly for isolated cavitary disease or even focal bronchiectatic disease. And I think we all have our surgical services, and I think, you know, National Jewish really pioneered the way with this and probably has the largest experience doing this, but I think we're all doing it more and more as an adjunct in the right type of patient. And I'll just say that you really need a surgeon who knows what they're doing and who's willing to work with you really closely. And I, you know, really feel strongly about making sure people are on adequate antibiotic regimens before they go through surgery. So those are nuances we can talk about later, but I think it's an emerging tool that we're using more and more.
So top of the list right now is a very important question. How good are drug sensitivity tests for NTM?
Can we go now?
Yeah, that's a tough one, but there are answers. So anybody want to go? I'll weigh in on it.
Sure,
but,
go ahead.
Well, I think we heard earlier from Ken, you mentioned that in terms of the only drug that's associated with the resistance determination is associated with clinical outcome for MAC or the macrolides. For rifampin, kenzasiide, and there are some recent data regarding amikacin from Richard's lab in Texas. So I think that for most of the drugs, the answer is it doesn't correlate well with outcome. For those drugs, it does, and I think it's very important. There are other instances, however, where, like in National Jewish, people come, they're resistant already to the macrolides or to other agents, or they're intolerant. And as a clinician, I have to pick another drug. I could just pick something out of random, but I usually try to have something to guide me, and so sometimes I do use those MICs because I don't have anything else to guide me. I think it's probably more useful for the rapid growers, though, than the slow growers. But how do you guys use them?
Well, I see a dichotomy, and that there are organisms like kenzasia where there's pretty good prediction for treatment response with rifamycin susceptibility. I mean, you know, you can pick and choose. I guess it's another reason that, you know, you have to know something about the organism that you're dealing with. Yeah. It's not just generic. Does drug susceptibility testing matter in NTM? Okay, well, kenzasiae, marinum, zulgay, fortuitum, yes. And a boatload of the others, no. So it's not an easy question. I'm sorry, that took a long time to spit out, but that's what I was trying to get at.
Anything else?
No.
A few more in the last few minutes. So have you found that patients with alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency are more prone to acquiring NTM lung infections?
Well, you guys have that data.
At Chan, National Jewish published data showing for Mycobacterium abscessus that he felt that there was an increased risk, but I don't think it's been definitively determined that that's the case. But they have lung disease. If they have lung disease, they are at risk for Mycobacterium. Whether the lack of alpha-1 increases that risk or not, I don't think we know for sure, but Ed Chan feels that that is, in fact, the case.
I totally agree.
Let's see what else. Saw one down there. Oh, well, do you think the ATS diagnostic criteria apply to all species? You alluded to this earlier, but maybe just say, what
no.
do you think? No. Okay. You know, and so just so you know, the guideline committee is meeting to revise these NTM, the ATS IDSA guidelines on Thursday this week. And I think there's no question that this is going to be a very tough thing we have to tackle. We can't lump all the species in and say the same diagnostic criteria, the same treatment decision process is the same for Gordoni as it is for kenzasiae. But it's a very complex undertaking, but we are going to have to, I believe, address that issue. So this one we have to ask. Should we have primary care providers tell patients at risk to take baths instead of showers?
We'll let you take that one.
I just tell them to take at least one of them, you know?
Yeah.
At least once a week.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, this is a tough, I'm sure every one of you, and I know all of us get asked this
all the time,
either daily or weekly. And, you know, the answer is just not clear. We already heard from you that you get these from showers and dirt. And so, you know, showers. But, you know, I just have to tell you, we published a case a few years ago that was a dentist up in Marin who we tracked, we believe, with Ted Maris. I don't know if Ted's here. But the organism that was in his lungs to one of his bathrooms. He never used that bathroom again. He fortunately had another one. He drained his swimming pool. He drained his hot tub. He quit dentistry with the idea that I'm not going to get this again, right? I mean, he did everything he could do to avoid aerosol. He got it again 2 years later. So this has always sat with me, which is I have to be very careful about making people have drastic changes in their lifestyles without some idea of what is the risk reduction that would occur. Because there's other things. I think about it like TB. Ventilate, you know, put a fan in the bathroom, open the windows, take shorter showers, wear N9. No, I'm just kidding. but there are ways to think about it in terms of just diluting the concentration, just like we do with TB. But I don't know. What do you guys tell patients when they ask you this question?
All I can say it is the most common question that we get asked, not necessarily about the showers, but patients want to know what they can do to, you know, mitigate the chances of this recurring or being repeatedly infected. My answer is very similar to yours. I think that, you know, it's important that the patients live their life and, you know, to restrict them from traveling or, you know, restrict them from taking showers when the evidence is not that great, I think is difficult. You know, one thing I think has been helpful is that, you know, Joe Falkenham is a scientist, an environmental microbiologist at Virginia Tech, who's done a lot of work on environmental transmission and looking for where these organisms are. He's published a very nice paper that kind of lists a variety of different types of exposures and sort of the pros and cons about, you know, whether or not that's likely to make a difference. I've gotten in the practice of just giving patients that paper and telling them, you know, if it feels that they're empowered by choosing the things that are most practical for them to choose, whether it's, you know, avoiding the ice makers on the refrigerators or things that aren't going to drastically change their lifestyle, I think many times it makes them feel like at least they're doing something that may make a difference. But I think there's very little science to connect these exposures and the subsequent either reinfection or more difficulty eradication of the organism.
Any final comments?
Yeah. Totally agree.
Totally agree. Well, I think we're at the end. I want to thank all of you for being here. This is fantastic to see this interest in NTM and just charge you to go out, think about NTM, try to diagnose it, and let's treat them. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
So please, let's give one round of applause for our distinguished faculty. On behalf of Insmed and NTMIR, we'd like to thank you for coming out. We have one final message from Philip that we'd like to share with you. Thank you again.
NTMs are everywhere in our environment, yet most of us have no idea what danger they pose nor the chaos they can cause in our lives. When Fern became ill, we had no idea that the battle she would wage would be so costly in time, lifestyle, side effects, and money. We had no idea that it was literally do or die, and we didn't realize that our idea of a normal life was about to change so completely. I remember the day in 1996 when we were told that Fern's drug treatment had failed and part of her lung needed to be surgically removed. Since then, our new normal to keep Fern alive includes a mind-numbing daily regimen, IV drugs, numerous pills, inhaled medicines, and airway clearance so she can cough out the secretions that have invaded and permanently damaged her lungs and airways. These are life-saving treatments without which Fern cannot live. Fern and other patients need better options. But Fern decided to turn overwhelming adversity into an unyielding commitment to do something to help others. We have met people from all over this country who have been similarly devastated by NTM lung disease. They have come face to face with the same dilemma, limited options and a new normal. Though some have called our mission a couple's crusade, the truth is that Fern leads and I follow gladly. I am driven by the fear of joining the ranks of too many who have lost loved ones. Fern is the center of my life, of our children's and grandchildren's lives. My job is to help her because she wants to live, and in so doing, she inspires other patients and indeed her physicians and me. You too can help patients by telling your colleagues about NTM and participating in the quest for better treatments and a cure. It will happen, and we should all be part of it. Thank you for being here, and our thanks to Insmed for making this evening possible.